Elba?
I've been thinking about Elba for a long time, and it brought me to Proverbs 31, and I never knew her husband, but I heard a lot about him, so I'm just going to change some of the wording here in Proverbs 31, verse 10 on. Excuse me. A wife of noble character, who can find? She's worth far more than rubies. Her family has full confidence in her. It lacks nothing of that. She brings them good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wood and flax and works with eager hands. She is like a merchant ship bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it's still dark, providing food for her family and portions for her servant girls. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sees a battle work vigorously. Her arms are only strong for her tasks. She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes everything for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. The family is respected at the city gate. When they take their seats among the elders of the land, she makes linen garments and sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children are and call her blessed. Her family also, they praise her. Many women do noble things, but she surpasses them all.
Amen.
Amen.
Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her her reward that she has earned, and let her words ring her praise at the city gate. There'll be time afterwards for anyone who's interested or wants to share a word about Elba to come up. We're changing our service around a little bit today. A mother is a special thing. You know, it hurt. You know, I lost my mother, I loved my mother. Jenny, Eddie, Lillian, I loved your mom too. To borrow from John, a couple weeks ago he was talking about kitchen sink moments. On Tuesday mornings, Elba would come, and I sometimes was still there doing the dishes for Chris. And she would come in with her container of plantains, which I never heard of before. And then other times she would bring, Peter, I made you roast pork. You know, she would bring a dish. And then at the holiday season, she would come with coquito. She was always giving, always loving. And Chris and the Lady Bibles used to go up to our cabin up in the Catskills up in Middleburg. And there was, she came home one time and she goes, Peter, forgive me, I had one of your beers. So she was down to earth. She was a great woman. But we surely missed by family and friends. So, just at this time, I'd like to pray for our world, our country, and for all our families. He knows our needs, He knows our wants, and He will provide us with everything in abundance. And we thank Him and praise Him in the Son's precious name. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, if you would like to say a few words about Elba, we have set aside time for you to come up. If you could come up, yes, you could be brave to come up because we do have Zoomy friends who can come to church every Sunday and they need to see you and hear you too. So, Danny, are you coming first?
I am.
Okay. Nice guy.
Thank you.
this church this full. So thank you, everyone, for coming out today and celebrating this amazing woman that we have the privilege to call mom, and for her grandchildren to have the privilege to call mama, and little by little, that endearment just was contagious, and everyone started calling her mama, and she loved it. Start out, I don't really remember my dreams. I don't dream. When I do, it's usually nightmares. My girl's like, "Don't tell me." About 2 weeks after mom went home to the Lord, I went to Alexa and Eli's house for the first time. I hadn't seen the new house. And I stayed overnight, and that night, I had a dream, very vivid dream. And it was today, but we were outside, it's a white tent, and we were like in the city street, because I was outside, and I was looking across the street, cars were passing. And I'm waiting, and here she comes. Mom comes running from across the street. She had a blue blouse, black pants, and a head of white hair, and she was fine. This is probably, you know, obviously before cancer. And, probably not, it's probably now, where she is now. And she came crossing the street with her back straight, her head held high, and her little rushing, you know, run. She was late, because, you know, all Spanish, we were late all the time. I said, "Come on, hurry up, hurry up." I said, "Look, they're all waiting for you." And so you guys were all under this white tent. She's crossing the street, she goes, "Who are all these people?" I said, "I don't know, they're here for you." And she's like, "Oh." So the next second, I was up here, and I was giving her testimony. And so I woke up about 3 in the morning, hysterical crying, obviously. And I said, "Okay, that's what you want. You want your testimony." So many, many days, many Sundays, we sat right around where my sister's at. And there were times when people were able to come up and give their testimonies. And she's, "I want to go up, I want to go up." And she was always embarrassed of her Spanish accent. She wasn't a good public speaker. And by the time she had the courage to come up, the moment was gone. So many a times she just didn't do it. She did it in the privacy of her small Bible study on Tuesdays, maybe, and maybe one of you, two of you know from a personal conversation with her. But bear with me, I was 87 years old. Her testimony is not short. When mom was 6 and her younger brother was 2, her mom had contracted tuberculosis from an uncle who came from the Navy. And he gave it to her mom and another sibling, another sister, another aunt. And she was sick for 2 years. And so after she got sick, they really quarantined the kids and they wouldn't let anybody near her. So my grandmother died when mom was 8. But she really lost her mom when she was about 6 because she wasn't around. My grandmother was 28 when she passed. She went from house to house. My grandfather, you know, he was working, but he was an angry man, always lost his job, so they didn't have much money. And she went to her maternal grandmother. She went with him, and she had a hard life. Learned how to cook and clean very early. She helped pretty much raise her little brother. She was not a saint. She had a little smart mouth. She remembers going to her grandfather's, and he had one little goat, and she would go and she would steal the milk from the goat, and she said she would go in the corner, and she said it was the most delicious, creamiest milk. And then her grandfather would fight with the neighbor, thinking that he stole the milk. She wasn't about to say anything. But she always was looking for the Lord. Mom went to church by herself at the age of 8 or 9. No one took her. She just went. Not her father, not her aunts. She always was in awe of even that, like she just was looking. Well, the years went by. Mom only made it to sixth grade. Her family didn't have the 35 cents it took to register for seventh grade. She worked, she tried to save her money. As the years passed, like I said, she had a little smart mouth. I don't know where we got this from. She had a big fight with her father and her stepmother, and she ended up leaving, and she came to New York at the age of 17. She stayed with an aunt here. Her aunt had like 9 kids. That didn't work out. They asked her to leave. This is just too many mouths to feed. So Mom was here by herself, at the age of 17. She saw her first snowfall from a small apartment in Lower Manhattan, all alone. As the years passed by, she saved money, and she sent for her father, and then she sent for her little brother. And her father was verbally abusive. It's not good, he's not a nice man. Her brother didn't really have direction and was stealing from her, and wasn't that great of a kid, but she didn't care, it was family. And through the years, she got married early. She was married at 19. She said she married because she was trying to get away from her father. By 22, she had 2 children, alone, no sisters, no mom. She learned how to raise her kids and do what she could on her own. Unfortunately, she was divorced early by 28, 29. Again, always going to church, always searching. Years later, she met my father. She had friends. She started going to clubs. She was dancing. I don't know if there's a picture out there. She had a beehive. And she thought she had a stomach bug. Flu, I guess. I'm a flu. Surprise. Soon after I was born, she found out my father had been lying to her, and he was married. And so she pulled up. Because if anybody, everybody who here knew her, she was about 4'10". She was a spitfire, and we were terrified of her. She raised me and my sister and brother alone. She was a single mother again. I remember giving her Mother's Day and Father's Day cards. She was old. She worked as, she only went to sixth grade, but when she got here, she got her GED, and she went to work at Wade Nursing Home in the Bronx as a nurse's aide, working nights. And she put me through Catholic school all the way to 12th grade. She never asked for a dime from either of our fathers. She did her work. And again, always going to church, always telling us. And she always told us also that that stepmom who she had the fight with, and she was the one that taught her how to read the Bible. She had children from my grandfather, and she had her daughter, and you know, that's my mother's other sister and brother, and they're here too. Uncle came from Puerto Rico. Again, you know, always going to church, always forgiving, always so loving. I remember one day I came home from school, and Mom had in her room saints with candles, and all of a sudden they were all gone. And I was like, what's she doing? And she says, I threw them all away. She goes, that's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for something else. I need to find a church. And I was like, well, you're gonna get in trouble. Like, you can't just go this thing out. So I was like, okay, Mom, you know, that's up to you. And we moved to the South Bronx, moved to Zurita, and again, praying for church, praying for church. And one day we went to Jersey, visit my brother, and out in Jersey in the park, this man was giving out tracts, these little papers, you know, introducing you to the Lord, inviting you to church. And so she grabbed the tract, she's reading it, and the bottom, it's a church on Castle Hill, which was about 7-minute walk from our house. We're in New Jersey. And so she was just in awe and realized how long God's arm is. So we got back to the Bronx. She called the church. Little woman named Nana King told her that that man who was in Jersey with those tracks was not supposed to have those tracks that day. Someone else was supposed to take them to Long Island. He took them by mistake. So it was a mistake. This is where Mom ended up going to church, the Baptist Church in the Bronx. Mom was baptized in 1991. She just felt happy. She went to Tres Diaz. She started going to Bible study. She was in the Bronx. She took care of her father, who I said was not a nice man. She didn't care. And her brother, she was always there for her brother. She moved in with us when Jasmine was probably about 3 or 4, and it was right after my grandfather died. And I said to her, I said, Mom, you know, you don't have anything else to be in the Bronx for. Come live with us. Like, you're paying rent, you're doing everything all day by yourself. And she said to me, I'll come. You have to find me a church. And I was like, oh, okay. So I'm going to find you a church, but don't ask me to go. I'm Catholic. If you want to do your thing, you do your thing. And she said, okay. Never pushed. So she was going to go find the Methodist church. So and next door, she sees a little sign that says Taconic Christian Church. I went there. And so she started coming. I dropped her off on Sunday morning. And of course, the lecture was like, she would go with her. And I drop her off and I drive away. And it wasn't I was driving away to the church. I was Catholic, but I wasn't at church. I felt I went to school for 12 years. I didn't. But the guilt. You know, like I was just like, all she wanted, like, you know, I know she wants me to go to church. She's taking care of my kids. Like, why can't I just go in? And so I started going. And so little by little, she brought us all to the Lord with her quiet spirit. And she loved her little church. She loved her church family. She loved her Bible study group. And she was just in awe on how God just was always there. So this is that was Mom's testimony. Now let me tell you about the mom I know. The mom I know is the most forgiving, most compassionate, most loving, most amazing, most gift-giving, most faithful woman I've ever known. She forgave her father. She forgave her brother. She ended up taking care of her stepmom for a while. She taught us the Bible. The reason we were crying is because those songs that were sung, she would be singing throughout the day. She found joy when we all saw sorrow. She was diagnosed with cancer 5 years ago, and she said, I can't complain. Our neighbor's son had passed away at 10 years old of cancer a few years before, she said. I'm 80 years old. I can't complain. And I was like, yes, you can. Mom would pray or ask if you had prayer. And she always taught us to start with praises. And she'd start praising, and she'd never get to her prayers. Because she always had just too much to praise God for. She was just so thankful. And she, what he was reading, he doesn't realize, Mom always said her only love and her best love was Jesus. Mm-hmm. That was her husband. And to think of a godly wife. Everything she did, she sewed this tablecloth here. and the one over here. I think most of us have pillowcases or something that she's been wearing. And I read somewhere recently that a grateful heart is a giving heart. And there wasn't a time when Mom didn't want to give a gift. Her last time at the hospital when she had surgery, she drove my sister, my brother, and I insane. And we had to go and get chocolates because she had such a nice nurse. And we had to bring chocolates. And then one morning, I was going to get her, and she's like, "You have to bring me those patches for the pain." And I'm like, "Fine, just ask the nurse for that." She goes, "No, bring it, bring it." And I brought it, and the lady who takes the blood, she was like, "Here, give her the," she was 17, she had a back pain. And so in the hospital, she's giving, you know, she's helping me. I was like, "Please." But throughout her struggle, she always, again, she found joy. She found joy in the Lord. She was always singing. She was always humming. She was always singing to the Lord. I miss her voice in the house. But she taught us by giving. And when she was not singing and humming, she was dancing merengue or, you know, some salsa. And she was having a beer every once in a while and beating us all in Scrabble or cards. And so she knew how to have fun. She lived. She had fun. She enjoyed life. I just want to read something from her Bible that I found after. It's a little Spanish Bible she had in her room. And she wrote this on December 2nd, 2020, which was her brother's birthday, who passed that year earlier. And Mom was 86 when she wrote this. She was 87 when she passed in January. And she wrote, "Dear God, thank you for your son Jesus, for all he did at the cross, for all sinners, for my sins, for walking with me all this 87 years. You have never left me, you've never forsaken me. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your angels, and thank you, Jesus, for those beautiful children you gave. I know they are blessed like me, and for my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren. I am so blessed, Lord. Thank you, Lord." Psalm 40. Mom wanted me to give her testimony today. But this room is her testimony. Because you are all here because of the woman you saw and the woman you knew. And if, for a few of you who have never met her, you're here for family who she touched and who behaved the way she taught us to behave. So her testimony is in this room, and I thank you all. Because I know she's in heaven with her mouth open, because I don't think she realized how loved she was. And I think there's about as many on Zoom that could not make it. So I just want to thank you again for all being here. And I am so proud and honored to have had such an amazing mother. And I'll tell you what she said. Always. She said, "I was poor. We don't have much." She said, "I was poor, but now I'm rich." She was alone. Now she was blessed to have such a big family, her church family, her friends. She was just so thankful for each one of you here. So, that's it. Thank you again for celebrating.
Paula, can you run out? You can run it again. Thank you. speak. If I wanted to speak today, and I told her it would be an honor, I could talk about Elba forever. For hours on hours, but I'll try to keep it short. I've known Elba for what seems like a lifetime. I remember when we first met, she was taking Alexis to Tom Thumb and pushing Jasmine in a stroller, and I was taking Justine to Tom Thumb. She was an awesome lady. By the way, sir, you gotta meet my family, which we did. And we became family that day on. She would make you laugh. She would always be there for you. She was always there for me, I know that. She wasn't shy about telling you about Jesus Christ. I too was, well, Catholic, even though I didn't go to church. But her talking to me about God, she didn't force it on me. You know, she just spoke. And she led me to Taconic Christian Church. I gave my life to the Lord. God used her, not only with me, but I know with a lot of people, used her to give his word. And I'm forever grateful for that. I stopped going to church only when I left New York. I moved to Florida. And I remember I continued to seek God because Randy, as a matter of fact, gave me to name some churches, and I'm still going to that church.
Amen.
But every chance that I get, I tell everybody about Elba, because she was special to me. Our kids grew up together. We were always at the house every weekend, playing cards. Now I know that Jenny, my wife, Lily, and Eddie would never admit it, that me and Elba were partners and we always wanted cards. She was an awesome lady. While our kids played downstairs in the basement, we played upstairs to play cards. When I needed inspiration, she was the person I called, even though I was down in Florida. I make it a point to come to New York every 6 months now to see my daughter and my granddaughters and my son-in-law. And my daughter will tell you, I don't visit too much family here in New York, and I do have a lot of family. But I made it a point, I had to come see Elba, Jenny, and the girls. Because they are family to me. I miss her, as I know everybody does. She was so special. I always said this is my partner because we were always playing cards. And she had a name for me, and she said I was her Pooh Bear. She's the only one that can call me. She's so special. When I first introduced her to my mother, she told my mother, you may have given birth to him, and he's yours, but he is mine too. And I mean, they got along great, you know. She was a source of strength for me when my mother passed. And I missed her. I had written some stuff down, but I can't even find it now. So. I just, you know, Jasmine, Alexis, Jenny, Lily, and Eddie, your mother want you to continue leading your life with Christ in it. She's looking down at you, and she'll let you know that that's what she wanted. That's what she wanted when she was here. That's what she wants now. I know when she passed and she went up to heaven, one of the first things she did was tell God a joke. She's something else. Know that she is in a much better place now, a place that we would all love to be. And God willing, will be one day. She's no more pain, still being funny. So keep that in mind. Get strength from that, because I know you guys miss her. We all do. Father, I thank you for everything. Lord, watch over everybody and give us strength to deal with life without her here. But she'll always be in my heart as she is in yours. Thank you.
To spend a lot of time with her in my early years in life. I watched her many nights pray before bed, a practice that has inspired me to this day. Apart from the sovereign grace of God, Mama is the primary reason I'm in Christ. Her influence set the course of my life. In my late teens, while walking in darkness, her prayers over me were almost tangible. I sensed God so strongly with me as she interceded. Many years ago, she told me she felt God's Spirit leading me to read all of 2 Timothy chapter 2. And the entirety of it is precisely specific to what I've sensed from God for so many years, especially where Paul says, "Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a vessel for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work." And Mama was set apart for honorable use. Mama is a warrior, and her prayers have impacted so many, and her heart leaves behind inspiration that will influence generations to come. In closing, I want to thank Mama's church, my family as a whole, And I suppose you want to thank Didi. You submitted your own life to keep a fight in the good fight. Mama, thank you for keeping her in the fight. Thank you. We love you, Mama. And we'll see you again.
Okay.
Can you stand and sing?
Saved a wretch.
I have known Elba for several years, not nearly as I would have liked. Did you notice that she was always hugging these guys?
She gave the best hugs.
She was a good hugger. But enough I knew about her to know that she was surely a gift from heaven. But as is her wife, she does not reside here anymore. She has no pain, she has no sin, she has no tears, and she is walking, and I'll bet talking, with her Jesus right now. I imagine she's young again. I imagine she's dancing, singing, rejoicing, filled with hope and grace and love, all the good stuff that we want. As I was preparing my little message here, I was wondering, maybe she met my dad. He was my hero before he passed away. He loved Jesus too. He was my hero, just like Elba was your hero. I have old friends, a couple old friends that are buried in a cemetery right next to my house. Yes, I have very quiet neighbors. And it's a big cemetery, and so a couple of years ago, when I used to jog, I would jog each morning through the cemetery, and I would stop at certain points when I got winded. And I would think about these two particular people. I would always stop at their grave sites, and I would pray, not for them, because I knew where they were. They were with Jesus. But I would pray for their family. I wasn't sad when I cried for them, because, like I said, I knew where they were. I was just sad because I missed them. I would think about the lessons they taught me, about our interactions. And then I got lazy and I stopped jogging. I've got to get back up there. But I always knew that they weren't here anymore. This wasn't their home. Their home was somewhere else. When I would jog in that graveyard and I would get winded at certain points and take a breather, I always had certain spots that I kind of picked out. One of them was this spot where there was this nice metal bench. And so I would jog up to that point, and I would just kind of sit down, take a breather. And the grave site was immaculate. Always new flowers, always, it was just a beautiful, beautiful grave site, I guess if you could say that. And it had the girl's picture on it. Her name was Jessica. And she had passed away at 18. And so one day, as I finished my jog and I was coming back to my house, there was a man that was tilling the soil in front of her grave. And so I stopped and I said, "Oh, do you know Jessica?" He looked at me like I had four heads, and he said, "Yeah, I'm her father." And I went, "Oh." I said, "Well, I'm really sorry that she passed away, but I just want to let you know I've been praying for you for a long time, so it's nice to have a face to pray for." And again, he kind of looked at me like I was some nut. And he still looked so perplexed. I mean, he was speechless. But you know, I know that she didn't reside there anymore. I buried my father 15 years ago. I haven't visited the gravesite since. Not because I'm of remorse, but just because I know he's not there. I know where he is. And he's in here. Mankind has a tough time with death because we see it as an end instead of a bump in the road to eternity. But that is if, of course, if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ and are part of his kingdom, as Elba fully understood. Yet many of us still plan as if death in this world won't come, but it will, and it does, and we can't stop that. And then there is eternity. Man proposes, he says, I'll do this, and I'll do that, and then plans without the inclusion of God in those plans. And that's just plain dumb. We presume we have all the time in the world, but we don't know. Tomorrow, we could turn around, walk across the street, get hit by a car, and we're gone. And then we start eternity. But God disposes. He determines when time is up, when he wants a person to go home with him. It's not up to us to decide. It's his decision, and it's based on his wisdom. There is no certain unknown that people often do not consider into their life equation. No one is guaranteed a future. Tomorrow is a gift. But foolish men and foolish women still plan without including God in their future plans. Now, Elba didn't. She didn't. She knew. We call that wisdom. And there's a few things that I just want to go over. There is, number one, the complexity of life. Think about all that we're involved with during our regular day. Paying bills, making money to live, raising kids. And today it's even weirder. I have 5 kids that are all home. They shouldn't be all home. 23, 22, 21, 18, and 16 and a half. Okay, I'll take the teens. The other ones, they should be out. My wife and I, when we were 17, we left for college. We never came back. I thought that's the way it was going to be. I'm just kidding. Of course, I feel blessed. Not always. But as my friend pointed out, Dave, you are blessed that they're all home. Thank you, COVID. But things happen that we are unexpected, and we are often forced to change our plans on the run. Life is complex. It's complex. There's just no, especially today, especially what we're dealing with right now. Life is complex, and it rarely fits into a tight, secure, predictable pattern. second thing is that there's the uncertainty of life. Proverbs 27:1 says, "Do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what that day might bring forth." Isn't that the truth? Life is uncertain to us, but it isn't to God. Only when we are following what He is directing us to do can we be confident of tomorrow, because we know He's leading us. And the truth is, even if it takes an unexpected turn, we will know and believe He is in control of the events. See, Elba understood that. She got that. And then there's the brevity of life. To us, it seems long. We measure it in years. Do you realize that the fact is that we created time? That to God, time does not exist. It's only with us. But we compare God to eternity, where time has no meaning and it has no power. Time has no bearing or control over us. And just think, Elba is living in eternity. Time has no bearing on her. Our life might be 80 years if we're lucky, 90 if we're doing great. My mom is going to turn 100 this year. I think she's just a freak of nature. But compared to eternity, that is just a vapor. Just a breath. Imagine a line that has no beginning, has no end, and there's a little dot. Oops, that's your life. The psalmist in Psalms 90:12, he tells us some good ways. He says, "Teach us to number our days aright, that we might gain a heart of wisdom." Time is short, and we have to make the most of the time that we have. Elba did. Yet, are we going to mess up? Yes. Because we're humans. But she got right back on the horse. Right? She got right back in line. Okay, Jesus. And that's what we got to do. And then there's the fragility of life, that no matter how good somebody has it in life, no matter how much money and relationships and popularity, life still remains fragile for them, just as it is for us. No one is immune to this fact. Life is fragile. Life is fragile because we can't control the future, nor do we have the ability to hold it back, or even the wisdom to see what's coming up around the corner. It's like going through the jungle without a GPS. Or out on the ocean without a compass. I don't know if you've been out on the ocean without a compass, but that's a scary thing. I've been there for a little while. Until a boat came out to help us. But it's scary when you're sitting there going, do I go right? Do I go left? Do I go straight? Do I go back? I don't know. We get so hung up on the future that we let the now go by. And tomorrow is so very fragile. Don't leave for tomorrow what you could do today. And I'm not talking, and I'm not referring about tasks. Well, that's probably a good mantra too. I'm kind of lazy, so I probably should be my mantra. But I'm referring to things like the kind words you wanted to say, but you never did. Or the forgiveness that you wanted to give, but you never did. Or that grace that you needed to receive or give, but you haven't yet. The love that you held back because you didn't get what you expected. So you held it back. That thank you that you thought, but just not got around to sending. Life is fragile. Warren Wiersbe, a noted pastor, he once shared an experience. He was going through a cave, and he said that there was a maze with numerous tunnels, and that there was incredibly dark. And I don't know if you've been in a cave, that caves are really, really dark. And there's bats flying around, and it can be a scary place. And they got to what they called was Pulpit Rock, and the guy in charge of the tour, he gave a five-word sermon to his group that he was leading. And he said, stay close to your guide. Life is complex, it's uncertain, it's brief, it's fragile. Handle with care and with an attitude of humility, and for goodness sakes, stay close to your guide. It just makes good sense, doesn't it? Elba did. We rarely regret the good things that we have done, but we almost always regret the good things we wanted to do, but never had the time or so we thought. God wants us to include him in our plans because he knows the future. He wants what's best for us. His will for us is not to give us lives of torture and regret and drudgery, just the opposite. He wants to make them fulfilling and exciting and effective so that we can dance. So that we can say in our hearts, I have run the good race and finished my course. Elba was able to say that, knowing that she made an impact, and unknowing how much of an impact she actually made. She stayed close to her guide. She trusted. He knew the future better than her. And I'm sure she had her moments. I'm sure that there were points where she kind of like got off course a little bit and had to get back on, just like the rest of us. But one thing I do know, that she finished the race and she stayed the course. If you are God's, meaning that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, nothing can take you away from him. Elba knew that. Elba believed that. Elba lived that. And she died in that. And that was her foundation. And I'm sure today, she would say, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, what are you waiting for? You don't have to be a perfect person. You just have to ask him into your life. You don't have to change. You just have to ask him into your life. He does all that. He does the changes. He makes the difference. Elba knew that. Elba got that. Elba experienced that. And that's why we celebrate her life here today. Because he did something with her that she could have never done on her own. And he's not the kind of God
that is forcing himself into your heart and into your life. He knocks at the door and waits for you to open it. And then he gives you this gift. This incredible gift of eternity in his kingdom. And it's dirt free because he already paid for it. And that's what we're celebrating here. Each week we celebrate communion. And we celebrate the fact that God has knocked on our door and given us this gift of his kingdom. When we receive him into our hearts, and it's free. That's what the cross represents to us, because the cross is where we paid it all. So as we share communion, remember that gift, and I implore you, if you don't know him, it's not a big deal. But invite him in. Open the door. Ask him into your life. No, I'm not asking you to be a religious nut. I'm just saying start a relationship with Jesus Christ, because that's what Elba would have wanted. And does want. Before we share communion, let me just pray. Father, we just thank you for your word. And we thank you for our dear friend and mother. Grandmother, Elba. What a woman you made. And we thank you that she gave her life to you, and that you did something extremely significant with it. And we just pray, Father, that you would do the same in us as well. In Jesus' name. Thank you. You know, when I first came to the Taconic Christian Church, I was used to, I always been at churches where we did communion once a month. And they had communion every week. So I scratched my head. I'm like, this is kind of weird. But I have found it to be so refreshing. Because every week, I have to come back to Jesus. And so it's become actually something that I appreciate. It always brings me back to my center. Because I don't know about you guys, but man, during the week, I kind of lose my center. So I need something that'll bring me back to what's really my center, my foundation. So that night, Jesus had his disciples all gathered. I always say that night, I don't know, it might have been the afternoon, I don't know. But they were all together for this Passover meal. And he knew, and I was reading about that this week in Matthew, he knew what he was up against. He knew what was coming. And he broke the bread and passed it to his friends, his disciples. And he said, this represents my body broken for you. Whenever you do this, remember me. Must have been going through Jesus as he did it. And he poured the wine into the glass and he said, this represents my blood that will be spilled for you. And then he adds, for the forgiveness of your sins. Whenever you do this, remember me.
And all God's people said,
amen.
Would everybody please stand and let's sing that song together? I can almost really hear Elba singing with all of us today.
thank you for the cloud of witnesses that you have sent ahead of us to show us how to live, to show us that you're real. We thank you for help. And we pray, Father, that you would give us the ability to follow their lead, to walk in their steps. And we thank you that that's possible because of what Jesus did. And in Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen. Thank you for coming today and celebrating the gift of Elba. We all kind of have to say goodbye because there's another church coming behind us. So thank you for coming, and God bless you all. Thank you.